Good afternoon. My name is Dr. Jerome Hunt, and I am the Student Equity Coordinator and Assistant Professor in Political Science Department here at Long Beach City College. On behalf of the Black Heritage Committee, students, faculty, staff, administrators, the Board of Trustees, and Superintendent President Luann Bynum, I would like to welcome you to Long Beach City College's closing keynote for Black Heritage Month with Mr. Keith Boykin. Over the last month, we have presented a number of programs and events that have highlighted the African-American Black community, and we thank you for your support throughout the month. If you have missed any of our wonderful programs, please visit the Long Beach City College YouTube page, as many of the events were recorded. At this time, we would like to observe a moment of silence to remember the Black lives that have been lost during the pandemic, especially those of our Viking family, including Barbara LeMay, Cherie Gilroy, Cecil Fikes, Kimberly Jones, and Linus Annalim. Thank you. Today, I have the great pleasure to introduce someone who's not only inspired me politically, but in the work that I do in the LGBTQ community, and whose career I have been following since he was on the Showtime political reality show, American Candidate, Mr. Keith Boykin. Mr. Boykin is a CNN political commentator, former White House aide to President Bill Clinton, and New York Times bestselling author and four-time Lambda Literary Award winner. He is a graduate of Dartmouth College and Harvard Law School and has taught at the Institute for Research in African American Studies at Columbia University and at American University. Mr. Boykin.
I believe you're muted.
Sorry about that there. I don't know how that happened. So I'll go back. Mr. Boykin is a co-founder and first board president of the National Black Justice Coalition, a national civil rights organization dedicated to the empowerment of the Black lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer plus, and same gender loving people. Keith was a co-host of BET's My Two Cents, an associate producer on the film Dirty Laundry, and has appeared on numerous TV shows, including BET's Being Mary Jane. So without further ado, I give you Mr. Keith Boykin.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Hunt. I appreciate your introduction. I thought I missed out on something for a moment because I didn't hear anything, but I guess you were muted when it was happening. But thank you all for inviting me here. It's a pleasure to be able to speak to Long Beach City College remotely today. Hope everyone is being safe. And thank you for that introduction. I'll give you a word of warning that there's construction going on outside my apartment right now. So if you hear some noise, I have the window closed, but you can still hear a little bit of it. So if you hear some noise, you know what it is. But I wanted to begin by telling you a little bit about myself. I'm going to spend most of the time just sort of talking about my sort of experience, how I got to where I am here today, my background, different places I've been, and what it says about the state of affairs for our country today, specifically with regards to issues of race and sexual orientation. So first of all, I'm from St. Louis, Missouri, born and raised there in St. Louis, although I went to high school in Clearwater, Florida, attended college in New Hampshire, law school in Boston, and I've worked in San Francisco, Los Angeles, Little Rock, Atlanta, Washington, D.C., and currently here in New York City, where I live in Harlem. I've lived in 12 cities in my lifetime and visited 48 of the 50 states. Never been to Alaska, Hawaii yet. I've got to put that on my bucket list, but two states I want to visit. But I want to tell you, to start from the beginning with my college experience. When I went to college, I'd gone to high school in Clearwater, Florida, as I mentioned, and I went to Dartmouth College in Hanover, New Hampshire. So it was a bit of a culture shock to go from a very warm climate to a very, very cold climate. And while I was there, I got involved in the campus newspaper, the daily student newspaper. I became the editor of the newspaper while I was there, the editor-in-chief of the paper. And at that time, one of the biggest issues on college campuses was the question of divestment, which is the question of whether colleges and universities should be investing their resources, their funds, into businesses that did business with South Africa. Back in the 1980s, when I was in college, South Africa was still a racist apartheid regime. The white minority of South Africans ran the government and ran the country, even though the black majority had no power. And a lot of us were concerned about this. This is the reason why Nelson Mandela went to jail, why Stephen Biko was killed. We were concerned about what was going on in South Africa. And so students on my college campus erected a shanty town on the college green to demonstrate what living conditions were like for people who actually lived in South Africa, who were black. And it was to dramatize what the college was supporting with its funding. The college didn't like it, of course. And one day, a group of right-wing conservative students with a sledgehammer came to the campus green in the middle of the night and took a sledgehammer and started knocking down the shanties while people were sleeping in them. So it was a very disturbing event, as you can imagine. I was the editor of the school newspaper at that time. I was walking home across the college campus green around 2 or 3 in the morning. I saw the police cars had formed on the green, and I wanted to know what was going on. I went over to find out and discovered that this attack had just happened. So I raced back to the newspaper office and told them literally to stop the presses so we could put this story in the paper that day. And it was just the beginning of what became a tumultuous year on campus. The president of the college ended up resigning. The students took over the administration building. They took over the school library building on another occasion. And it was just a very, very sort of inspiring moment to see people of color, black people in this instance, standing up, speaking up for justice, for social justice. And it was one of the first moments that told me that now I'm getting this alert on my computer for some reason to install Adobe Flash Player. I don't know why this is coming on right now. So I hope I didn't lose anybody by disconnecting from that. You can still hear me, I assume, but I just clicked off of that. Anyway, so that was weird, but one of the things that I learned from that experience at Dartmouth was the importance of speaking truth to power. And this was a lesson that has stayed with me ever since that time, of speaking truth to power. And that's kind of the message of what I want to talk about today. After college, I went to work for the Dukakis for President campaign back in 1987, in June 1987, after I graduated. And Michael Dukakis at that time was a little known Massachusetts governor who was running for president. And nobody thought it was a good idea for me after graduating from college to go work for a campaign where I was being paid virtually nothing. They paid me $250 a week and I had to figure out a way to survive off of that in pay, which was okay actually for the first couple of months. And then I realized I had to pay back my student loans and it became almost impossible to live off of that. But somehow I managed to survive, which I don't recommend anyone, but somehow I managed to survive that experience. And afterwards, after a year of working for the campaign, Michael Dukakis became the Democratic nominee for president. And suddenly I got a pay raise and a new job. And the pay raise allowed me to live like a normal human being for the first time in a year after graduating from college. But the new job gave me a great opportunity to travel and see the world. So a lot of the places I've been to, that I mentioned before, the 48 states, a lot of those places were because I was able to travel for political campaigns, including the Dukakis campaign. So I went to places like Minot, North Dakota, and Sioux Falls, South Dakota, places I've never been since that time and have never really thought about going to, honestly. But I've been able to say I was able to go there because I had this wonderful experience traveling on the campaign plane with the candidate, the Democratic candidate, the Democratic nominee for president, and getting a chance to see the world and seeing how politics operates up close. I was a political science major in college. We call it government at Dartmouth, but I was a political science major. And seeing something work in reality is much different from seeing it talked about in theory. So the most of what we talked about in political science courses in college was all about theory. But then I got to see it up close in politics and in reality. And it was just fascinating for me. It kind of nurtured that political bug that I'd always had ever since I was a child. Well, after Dukakis lost his campaign, as you all know, he didn't become president, I realized that one of the reasons why he didn't do as well as he could have done is because of the issue of race. The George Bush campaign ran this ad, this Willie Horton ad, which used the image of a Black man who had been accused of raping a white woman in Massachusetts. And because he had been let out of prison at some point on a state furlough program that started before Michael Dukakis was president, Michael Dukakis was accused of letting Black people out of prison to go rape white women. And it became this huge scandal in the 1988 presidential campaign, but it was clearly based on racial overtones. And many of us were very concerned about the racial play that was at work here. It was a part of the Republican Southern strategy that had begun back in the 1960s with President Richard Nixon. And we were concerned about what this said about the future of our country and where we would be. And so it was a disturbing time for me to be involved with that. Interesting note about the way that America has changed from 1988 to today. By the end of the 88 campaign, after we lost, Democrats had lost 6 of the last 7 presidential elections. And Democrats were lost, basically. They had no idea what they were going to do next and how they were going to come back. But since that time, since that failed 1988 election, Democrats have actually won 7 of the last 8 presidential elections in the popular vote. Let me say that again. Democrats have won the popular vote in 7 of the last 8 presidential elections. Now, the reason why that's such a stunning statement is because, A, it shows the shift of where the country has moved to from where it was back in the time when I was in college. But B, it also reflects the fact that we have a system in place that prevents democracy from working. It prevents Black and brown people and people of color in general and people who are LGBTQ and people who come from different backgrounds and vulnerable experiences and marginalized communities. It prevents all of those people from being represented into our democracy. So we have a Supreme Court today that is made up of 2/3 of the members are made up of Republican appointees. And the Supreme Court is appointed by President of the United States. But Democrats have won the presidential popular vote in 7 of the last 8 elections. So we have this systemic problem in place. The same thing with the United States Senate. We have a systemic problem with the United States Senate, where we have states like Wyoming and Montana that have virtually nobody in them, that have 2 U.S. senators each for each of those states, whereas a state like California with nearly 40 million people only has 2 U.S. senators compared to the fact that it has 10 times the amount of people in some of these other smaller states. So that there is a representation problem that is structural in our country and our Constitution that needs to be addressed. And part of that, what we're seeing today, is that people are being fed up. They're getting fed up with what they're seeing, and they're demanding change. Young people especially are demanding change. They're saying that things don't have to be the way they've always been. Well, anyway, I left the college experience and went on to Harvard Law School, where I got involved in another movement, which was the movement for diversity on campus. When I was in law school at Harvard, there were virtually no people of color on the faculty. There were no women of color at all. There was one Black professor who was very well known. His name was Derek Bell. And he was one of my professors, and he took a leave of absence to protest the lack of diversity on campus. And because of this, there was a great deal of division on campus at Harvard, just as there had been at Dartmouth when I was there. So it's like controversy was always following me wherever I was. Well, anyway, I want to tell you a story. So I got involved in the movement for diversity in the first year in law school. I was holding up a sign, standing outside a faculty meeting, engaging in a protest with my fellow classmates. And the faculty members left the meeting and they streamed past us and basically ignored what we were doing. And then the dean of the law school walked out. And the dean walked past us and completely ignored what we were doing as well. So I called out to the dean. I said, "Hey, Dean Clark, why don't you come back and talk to us?" The dean's name was Dean Clark, obviously, Robert Clark. The dean turned around, realized that didn't know who I was, and kept walking. So I called again. I said, "Hey, Dean Clark, come back and talk to us." Once again, the dean turned around, realized it was the same kid or student yelling at him, and he ignored me. So I was so upset by this, and this goes back to the notion of speaking truth to power. I was so upset by this that I grabbed my backpack and slung it over my shoulder and took my sign and put it under my arm. And I began marching to the door to catch up with the dean as he was trying to leave. And the dean of the Harvard Law School, when he saw me coming, literally opened the door and began sprinting across the campus to get away from me. I actually have a photo of it too, which I'll tell you about in a moment. He began sprinting across the campus to get away from me. And one of the things I didn't tell you about in my background is that when I was in high school and college, I ran track. So I didn't want to miss an opportunity for a good race. So I went sprinting across the campus to catch up with the dean. And we had this scene of me, this first year student, chasing the dean of the Harvard Law School across the campus, and a photographer from the Boston Globe that we had invited to cover the event snapped a photo of us, and that picture appeared on the front page of the Metro section of the Boston Globe the following day. So instantly I became sort of infamous on campus or famous on campus, depending on your perspective, because of that photo of me chasing the dean of the law school across the campus. Well, we knew that we couldn't just chase the dean across the campus for the entirety of our time on campus. So we decided we would engage in other tactics as well. So we took over the dean's office on a couple of occasions on campus, and we went to the president's office and tried to take over that office, but we were unsuccessful in doing that because they saw us coming and they locked it down. But we realized that we had the school on the run. So we decided, since we were law students, the next best thing we could do was to take our school to court. So we filed an unprecedented lawsuit against our own law school. We sued them for discrimination in the hiring of the faculty. And we argued the case ourselves as students all the way up to the Massachusetts Supreme Judicial Court. We lost. We lost in technicality because the court said we didn't have the legal standing to be able to file the lawsuit as students. But we won in the court of public opinion because we were able to force the school to defend its discriminatory hiring practices in public. And so that was a victory that taught us a lot about speaking truth to power and being able to recognize that victory doesn't always come immediately, but sometimes it takes time before you actually are able to appreciate that. It was also when I was in law school that I started to come to terms with another part of my identity, and that was in my second year in law school. I remember one day walking to a bookstore in Harvard Square and looking at the LGBTQ section, which at that time they didn't have all the initials, and it was just the gay section back in the day. And I remember looking through the section nervously, hoping nobody was seeing me or watching me as I was in the bookstore looking for this book at night. And I didn't have a particular book in mind I wanted, but I just felt like I needed to go find out more about what I was experiencing. So I found a book, nervously took it to the counter, I purchased the book and slipped it into my backpack. I took the book home and I read that entire book that night. And immediately I came out to myself. Then the very next day I came out to my mom. Which was a very difficult thing to do because I'd known my mom for my entire life, obviously, and I was in my mid-20s at the time, and here I was making a phone call to tell her something new about myself that I wasn't sure how she would react. So I called her number on the phone, and she lived in Killeen, Texas at the time at the Fort Hood Army Base with her husband who was in the military. And I called her on the phone, and I couldn't place the call, so I hung up. I took a deep breath and I said to myself, I have to do this. So I tried again and I nervously dialed the digits of her phone number. And again, I took a deep breath and called, and before she could answer, I hung up the phone again. And this was all in the days before we had caller ID. So there's no way for her to know who it was who was calling or anything like that. And so finally I realized that I wanted to call, but I didn't know exactly what it was I wanted to say or how I was gonna say it. So I decided I would write down some notes. So I pulled out a pen and a paper, and I wrote down everything I wanted to say to my mom in this conversation. And then I wrote down everything I wanted my mom to say to me in response. So armed with this script, I was finally able to place the phone call. I took another deep breath, called my mom's number. She answered. We began speaking. And somewhere in the midst of a very difficult, complicated, perhaps convoluted conversation, I managed to sandwich in the words, "You know, Mom, I have something I want to tell you." You know, when you say that, you can't just talk about the weather or something trivial. So I knew I passed the point of no return. I didn't know exactly what I was going to say or how I was going to deal with this. So I said to her, "I don't know if you know this or if you thought about this, but this is something I've been thinking about for some time now. And I want you to know something about myself. I want you to know that I am gay." Well, that was the reaction that greeted me from my mom. Just silence for a few moments, just nothing being said. And after that awkward silence, she finally spoke up and she said, "I love you." And that was the most important thing that any mother, I suppose, but that was the most important thing that my mom could have said at that moment, because I took it as an expression of unconditional love, that she clearly didn't understand everything it was that I was communicating to her, or didn't understand what sexual orientation really meant in the same way I just read about in this book the night before. But she wanted to be supportive of her son. And she asked me questions. She said, "Are you sure?" I said, "Yes, I'm sure. It took me a while to figure it out, but I'm sure." She said, "Well, was it something I did?" I said, "No, it's nothing you did or didn't do. It's just who I am." And she said, "Well, maybe you just haven't met the right woman yet." I said, "No, that's not it either. It took me a long time to figure it out, but this is really who I am. And I don't expect you to understand it immediately, but at least I'm happy that you're able to be supportive." And my mom gave me some advice. She said she loved me and she supported me, but she told me, "Don't tell your grandmother about this, because it'll just kill your grandmother if she finds out about it." So I remembered. When I was very, very little, my mom used to always tell me, "Don't let anybody tell you what to do." So I decided I would remember my mom's earlier advice of not letting anyone tell me what to do. And I actually began the process of telling people. I came out to people. She had told me, by the way, not to tell too many people. And I started telling people. I started telling people, almost everyone I knew, for a while. And then I realized that I didn't really want to come out to everybody. I wanted to be out. And I discovered that there was a difference between coming out and being out. That being out simply means being open and honest about who you are. Coming out involves some affirmative act of disclosure, of having a conversation with someone, and that whole sort of dramatic, sometimes traumatic experience that people endure. And I didn't want to go through that over and over again. And today there's a new language for this, that we don't even necessarily use coming out anymore. A lot of people started using the term inviting in, especially in the Black queer community, because the coming out term involves sort of a different perspective than inviting people into your life. And so I discovered that there was a rule for me about inviting in or coming out, what I call the first rule of coming out, which was this: if you tell the right people, you don't have to tell everybody else. And I realized this because I only told, I think, a handful of people before it seemed that everyone else on campus found out about it, before I could even tell them. All my friends found out about it, including, oddly enough, one of my professors. And I remember sitting in the meeting with my professor, and at the end of the meeting, kind of partially closed the door and leaned on his desk and leaned over at me and said to me, "So I hear that you're gay now, is that true?" And I was shocked by this, because for a long time, I'd actually thought that the professors, the faculty at Harvard Law School, had more important things to do with their time than to speculate about the sexual orientation of the students. But this is what really happened. And then I realized that many of us as students had spent a great deal of our time speculating about the sexual orientation of the faculty. So it seemed to be there was some cosmic balancing act going on all around. But it was not entirely negative experience. It was actually a very positive experience. It was an affirming experience. And I don't remember anyone of my friends who I encountered responding negatively to me when I came out. And even in my family, my father, my sister, my mom all reacted positively. The only person who didn't react positively was my grandmother. Now, mind you, I didn't actually tell my grandmother. She found out from other sources, like everyone else did, I guess. But when I graduated from law school, as I was on stage receiving my degree, my grandmother had a conversation with my boyfriend, and she told him that she did not approve of my lifestyle. And she insisted that he, my boyfriend, give to her his mother's telephone number so that she could call his mother and talk some sense into her or something. Now, this is weird, obviously, and I didn't know exactly this was going on until after the fact. And when I found out about it, I confronted my grandmother and I told her, what are you doing? Why are you doing this? And she told me that she was getting ill, physically ill, she said, just thinking about my lifestyle. I told her, look, my quote-unquote lifestyle is the same as it was before. I'm the same person. There's nothing different about my lifestyle than it was before. My sexual orientation is the only thing that has been confirmed, and that isn't even different, something I'm just now becoming aware of. But those two things are not the same. But if anything, I told my grandmother, I should hope that you'd be happy for me, happy that I'm able to live my life freely and openly and be honest about who I am and not have to live my life in the closet or on the down low. But my grandmother was raised in the church tradition and she didn't even quite see it that way. And so we argued about this and we didn't convince each other. It was a very disturbing experience for me, but I learned to move on. It was the only negative experience I really felt when I came out. And it was from somebody who was very close to me, so that it was hurtful. But I moved on. After that whole coming out experience, I continued in being engaged on campus with other activities, including the diversity movement. But something else happened while I was in law school. It also shaped my future. And that was a visit from a presidential candidate. And there was a guy named Bill Clinton, who was the governor of Arkansas. And Bill Clinton came to speak on campus at the Harvard Kennedy School in 1991. And I wasn't a student at the Kennedy School. I was a student at the law school, but I knew some people over there. So I got a ticket to go there and I went to see Bill Clinton speak at the Kennedy School. At this time, he was just the governor of Arkansas. He wasn't the president of the United States. And not a lot of people really, except for people in the political world, really knew that much about him. But the event was packed. And I remember at the end of the event, a student in the audience asked a question. They said to him, well, since you're running for president, would you be willing to lift the ban on gays in the military? And Clinton said he'd never been asked that question before, but he said, yes, he would. He'd be willing to do that. At that moment, I thought to myself, wow, this is a Southern Democratic governor who's willing to lift the ban on gays in the military. I'm surprised, but it was a reflection of just how much things had changed, in my opinion, from 1988, because Michael Dukakis, the Massachusetts Northern liberal who I'd worked for in 1988, never even mentioned LGBTQ issues in his campaign. So here we are 4 years later in 1992, and we have the Southern Democrat who's talking about lifting the ban on gays in the military. So that was a sign to me of just how things had been had changed. And by the end of that 1992 campaign, every single Democratic presidential candidate endorsed the idea of lifting the ban on gays in the military. That was the first time, and to my knowledge, in any presidential election where the Democratic Party and all the Democratic candidates essentially endorsed the pro-LGBTQ position in a presidential campaign. Well, one other thing happened while I was in law school. Another one of my classmates, it seems like a lot happened in law school, I know, right? Another one of my classmates was elected as the first Black president of the Harvard Law Review. And his name was Barack Obama. And he became the president of the Law Review, which is one of the most prestigious legal journals in the country and on campus. And it helped to underscore the point we were making on campus in our diversity argument, in our diversity movement, that you could have people who were both quality candidates and qualified candidates who were also who also came from diverse backgrounds. Because a lot of institutions of higher learning claim that they can't find qualified candidates of color, or qualified faculty, or qualified staff, or administrators of color. And they make you feel like if you have diversity, then you're somehow going to sacrifice quality. You're going to sacrifice your standards and educational requirements. And the reality is it's not true. And that diversity actually helps all of us, not just Black and brown people. It helps all of us. It helps to shape the experiences that we get to see in the classroom and outside the classroom, and doesn't filter them through a narrow lens of white patriarchal identity. So we were gratified that Barack Obama had joined, not our campaign, but had sort of given voice to the movement that we were speaking about. And he did come and speak at one of our rallies, and he spoke in defense of Professor Bell, the professor I mentioned before, who was taking a leave of absence. But that was the beginning of my whole diversity experience back in law school. Anyway, I'm moving forward. And I'm really hot. I have this light on me right now, so I'm really hot, and I have the window closed for the construction. So I apologize if that's the reason why I'm sweating. But anyway, I want to talk some more about what happens next. So after I left law school, I went to San Francisco to work for a law firm. And while I was in San Francisco, I was studying for the bar exam when I received a phone call from someone named Didi Myers, who I'd worked with in the 88 campaign. And she asked if I'd be willing to work for Bill Clinton, who was running for president. And I immediately said yes. I quit my job at the law firm before I'd even started, drove my Hyundai Excel across the country from San Francisco to Little Rock, Arkansas, and started working for the Clinton-Gore presidential campaign. In 1992. And this was an odd decision to a lot of my family members, because they thought, well, why did you spend all this money and go into all this debt to go to Harvard Law School if you're just going to go work for another low income job in a political campaign? And that was a good question. And I didn't necessarily have a good answer, especially since they knew my political track record, which I should tell you about as well, that I started working in politics long before that time. When I was in high school, I worked in my first political campaign back in 1982. And I worked for a guy who was a liberal Democrat in Clearwater, Florida, who's running for Congress, named George Sheldon, and he lost. And 2 years later, in 1984, I volunteered for Walter Mondale when he ran for president, and he lost. And then 2 years after that, in 1986, I found myself in Atlanta, Georgia, and I worked for a congressional campaign for Julian Bond, the former civil rights leader who later became the head of the NAACP. But he was running for Congress in 1986, and I volunteered on his campaign, and he lost. And then in 1988, of course, after I graduated from college, I worked for the Dukakis for President campaign, and he lost. And then in 1989, I worked for a license collector candidate. I don't even know really what a license collector does, but I worked for a license collector candidate in 1989 in St. Louis, Missouri, and she lost. So by 1992, when I told my family I was going to go work for Bill Clinton, who was running for president, nobody thought it was a good idea for me to do this, because they all knew my track record. They knew that I had never worked for anybody who won anything before. So nobody was more surprised than I was when Bill Clinton actually won the election in 1992. It was the first time I had ever worked for anybody, ever won anything, and I didn't know what to do with myself. And suddenly I found myself with this job after Clinton won the election, working in the White House as a special assistant to the president, the highest ranking openly gay person in the Clinton White House, and becoming a liaison to the LGBTQ community and the LGBTQ organizations. And I had just come out less than 2 years before. So I'm gonna take a break here and get me a napkin to wipe off my hair. All right, stay with me now. All right, so I had just come out less than 2 years before, and I was working in the White House as a part of the Clinton administration. And one of the first issues we had to deal with was the question of lifting the ban on gays in the military, the same issue that Bill Clinton had talked about at Harvard Kennedy School, where he promised that he would do this. And he was having a lot of difficulty doing it because there was a lot of resistance from both the military and religious communities who were upset about the idea. But for me, it struck me that a lot of the arguments that were being used to justify discrimination against LGBTQ people in the military were almost identical to the arguments that were used to justify discrimination against African Americans in the military, until President Harry Truman in 1948 signed an executive order integrating the U.S. Armed Forces. And there was a lot of resistance to that. People said this is wrong for religious reasons, because this is going to violate the separation of the races, which God had ordained, which I don't know what kind of God they believe in to think that, but they were actually saying this in 1948. And they said that if you allow gay people to serve in the military in 1948, if you allow Black people to serve in the military next to white people, you're going to create a problem with, quote, unit cohesion. And basically, the units won't be able to be cohesive. They won't be able to work together as effectively. And they use that same argument, both those same arguments in 1993, when Clinton was in office, that they had used in 1948, even though those arguments had been discredited decades before, half a century before. So Clinton was having a lot of resistance to this issue. And it was around that time in 1993 when a group of us in the White House started working on holding a meeting with President Clinton and LGBTQ leaders. At that time, believe it or not, no president in history had ever even sat down with members of the queer community or LGBTQ organizations to speak to them about what their concerns were. So in the entire history of the country until 1993, no president even sat down with leaders of the community to do anything about this. Now, mind you, the LGBTQ movement essentially started in the modern terms at Stonewall in 1969. But still, in that time, from 1969 to 1993, no meetings, no president ever had done this before. And so we met, we set up this meeting with the president to talk with the LGBTQ community leaders. And I remember, one of the people in the meeting asked the president what he thought he'd be remembered for in history. And he said he thought he'd be remembered for two things. One, for lifting the ban on gays in the military. And two, for universal health care. Now, mind you, or health care reform, he might have said. Now, mind you, Bill Clinton did neither one of those things. He didn't lift the ban on gays in the military, and he didn't reform the healthcare system. He tried and failed with both of those issues. So huge campaign for 2 years on healthcare reform, a shorter campaign in the first year for lifting the ban on gays in the military. And each issue, he faced so much resistance that he couldn't do it. And ironically, the person who ended up doing both healthcare reform and lifting the ban on gays in the military was my former law school classmate, Barack Obama, when he became president years later. So I worked for the Clinton administration the first term, and afterwards I started to get frustrated with the lack of progress that was taking place. The Bill Clinton had this policy approach of what we call triangulation, where he was trying to get, he didn't want to come across as a liberal because a liberal ideology didn't work for the past Democratic candidates. He didn't want to come across as a conservative because he knew he would get no Democratic votes. So he's trying to position himself somewhere in the middle, this whole idea of triangulation. And it was a clever political strategy, but it was devastating in terms of what it actually did in terms of setting back some of our movement ideas. So Bill Clinton ended up signing the Defense of Marriage Act, which is an anti-gay bill, which basically, it was supposed to be a compromise measure to stop a constitutional amendment to prevent outlawing gay marriage in the Constitution. But it actually ended up codifying discrimination in the law by saying that the federal government recognized marriage as only between a man and a woman. And Bill Clinton signed that Defense of Marriage Act in 1996. He also signed the crime bill, which a lot of you probably heard about from previous presidential elections. But the crime bill, which helped to contribute to the policies of mass incarceration, it didn't cause mass incarceration, because that had started decades before with the Nixon administration, the war on drugs, and the Reagan administration as well. But it contributed to that as well. And lastly, he also signed the welfare reform bill, which basically, quote unquote, ended welfare as we know it. And it meant that people could still have access to welfare, but they couldn't stay on indefinitely. There was a time limit for it. So even if you're going through some extraordinary difficulty in your life or some horrible circumstances, you ended up with a limit on how much time you could get federal welfare benefits. So all this is happening at a time when the Democratic Party was trying to sort of reposition itself after losing 6 out of 7 of the previous presidential elections. But the country was becoming more progressive, as we see now, as the country started to elect more and more Democrats over and over. So we have this schism going on in the 1990s, and Bill Clinton was right there in the crucible in the middle of all this happening. At the same time, I left the White House. I started working on my first book, which is called One More River to Cross, Black and Gay in America. I started talking about intersectional identities and what Kimberly Crenshaw talks about intersectionality. She talks about the importance of avoiding single issue analyses. And so I started talking about racism in the LGBTQ community and homophobia in the Black community and comparing and contrasting those things. And also started talking about the hierarchy of oppression that people use, the tendency to assume that we have to compare one group suffering with another group suffering. And whenever I would talk about these things as a Black gay man, people would say, oh, but you can't compare this struggle to that struggle. Well, it doesn't really matter that the struggles are the same or not. The reality is it doesn't matter which group is most oppressed or first oppressed or whether identically oppressed. What matters is that no group of people should be oppressed. Clearly, the LGBTQ struggle is not the same as the civil rights struggle for Black people. Clearly, the goals are not the same, or the communities are not the same, the issues are not the same. But that shouldn't matter. The question, each group suffers differently. The question should be, how do we eliminate oppression in general, and particularly for various groups and intersectional identities? Now, there's a tendency to think that a lot of these issues are issues of the past. But the reality is that racism is still a problem in the LGBTQ community, and homophobia is still a problem in the Black community. But what I want to do with my book was to sort of challenge some of the myths. And so with the issue of racism in the LGBTQ community, I talked about at that time what was going on in the 1990s. But even here in liberal New York City just a few years ago, I had to sue a local gay nightclub because they had discriminatory policies toward Black people. There were different nights that they marketed for white people and Black people. And I went there on 2 consecutive nights, and on the night that was targeted toward white people, could just sort of walk in the door with no problem. A night that was targeted toward Black people had to go through security and get frisked, and they wouldn't let my partner come in because he had Apple headphone cord, and they said they could be used as a weapon to choke somebody. I was shocked. I said to myself, "Are you serious? You really won't let him into the bar because he has iPhone cord with him for his phone?" And I told the manager, I said, "I was here yesterday, and they let everybody in." And the manager acknowledged to me that there was a different policy from white knights to Black knights, but they had to do it because the Black people were more of a problem. I can't believe he actually said this to me. I said to him, you know, that's against law, that's racially discriminatory. But he had no problem. He was so confident in his decision. He had no problem saying this to me. So I followed up with an email so he could say it in writing, and he confirmed this. So of course I took him to court because I'm a lawyer, and I sued him, and he lost. So, yes, racism is still an issue in the LGBTQ community. And homophobia is still an issue in the Black community. But this is a point where I want to make a caveat, because the tendency here is, I think, to assume that homophobia is worse in the Black community than in other communities. And I don't think that's the case. In fact, I did extensive research on this for my first book, and there was no evidence really to support this. But a lot of the evidence that people use is anecdotal. They had this experience with somebody, this Black person or this Black person in their family. But if you look at the statistical analyses, there's really no evidence backing this up. On all the public opinion surveys that have been conducted over the past 30 years or so, Black people tend to be as supportive or even more supportive of LGBTQ issues than white people on every single issue except one. And that's the issue of marriage. That's the one issue where Black people tend to be more conservative than white people. But on every other issue, Black people are actually as progressive, if not more progressive, than white people are. And what I think people fail to understand is that Black people are A, not monolithic, but also B, that Black people are multidimensional. That is to say that we are politically progressive, but socially conservative. And I'm not speaking about all Black people because I don't look at generalization, but in general, Black people are politically progressive, but socially conservative. And the social conservatism is largely rooted, of course, in the church and the religious traditions that we've inherited from Christianity. But politically, if you present the idea of should gay and lesbian people be treated equally, Black people almost always have been able to say yes to this because we recognize discrimination in our own community, and we've been more willing to say this in the past than white people have. But if you present it in terms of an issue of morality, this is where the social conservatism comes in, and Black people tend to be less supportive. So gay marriage was presented as a sort of morality play for Black people, and a lot of Black people were resistant to that. Plus, a lot of Black people were resistant to the idea of going back to the hierarchy of oppression I talked before, of comparing these struggles, the Black struggle with the gay struggle. And so if you take that issue of marriage equality out of it, you start to see that the homophobia in the Black community is no better or worse than the other community. Now, one of the other issues that the marriage equality movement brought up is that a lot of Black queer people were uncomfortable with the movement as well. And they were uncomfortable for different reasons. Now, I was a part of this movement back in the 90s and early 2000s, but part of the reason why they were uncomfortable is because they felt there were other issues, more pressing issues, more life and death issues, economic issues, even basic survival and safety issues that threaten Black queer people that wouldn't be solved by giving the right to marry to people. So we have a Black community that's still, even today, disproportionately affected by HIV/AIDS, and Black queer men, Black gay men, or Black same gender loving men, or Black men who have sex with men, are far more likely to be infected with HIV or even die because of HIV, even today in 2021, some 30 years after this, 40 years, I guess, since this epidemic first began. And so that's a first issue that people are saying, why aren't we focusing on the HIV/AIDS epidemic? Secondly, we still have issues of safety. Even today, we have Black transgender women who are being killed, murdered in our own communities all across the country. And these issues aren't even getting taken up. You don't hear these causes often as much in the Say Her Name movement. And so this is one of the concerns that Black queer people were concerned about even back in the at the beginning of the marriage equality movement. And there was the issue of basic discrimination. A lot of people felt that the Employment Non-Discrimination Act, what is now called the Equality Act, should be the first priority. Let's first give people the right to get hired for a job. Because until recently, even as of today, there is no federal law that protects LGBTQ people from discrimination in the workplace. Now, the Supreme Court just recently made a decision saying that the Civil Rights Act includes sexual orientation. But that was just in the past couple of years that decision came out. And before that time, people could be fired for any reason from their job. And in fact, it happened to a woman in Georgia, a woman named Cheryl Somerville, who was working at a Cracker Barrel restaurant. She was fired from her job and given a pink slip. And the pink slip literally said, the employee is being terminated because the employee is gay. Now imagine if someone did that in the context of race, and somebody said wrote a pink slip and said the employee is being fired because the employee is Black. That would be a smoking gun in a lawsuit. You would own Cracker Barrel after that. But in this case, there was nothing that she could do because there was no legal recourse and no federal law that protected her. At that time, there was no law in Georgia. Still, as I believe, no law in Georgia to protect her. So anyway. As we sort of talked about before, we start to see this evolution in the way that we understand these different communities, that Black people are not monolithic, the LGBTQ community is not monolithic. And by the time we get to the 2000s, America is really starting to change a lot. This is also a time when, as Dr. Hunt mentioned, I was on a television show called American Candidate on Showtime. We had to travel a country in sort of a mock presidential election. I was one of 10 candidates who competed in this mock election. So we went to New Hampshire and DC and California and all these different places, and we did debates and polls and TV ads and everything. And it was also a refresher about race for me, because at one point during the campaign, during my campaign, we were in Washington, D.C., and I recorded a television ad in front of the Lincoln Memorial. And I made the point, because my birthday was around the corner, I made the point that Dr. King gave his famous I Have a Dream speech here at the Lincoln Memorial on August 28th, the same day I was born. I wasn't born on the same day he gave the speech, but on the anniversary of the day, 2 years later. And so I've always felt a sense of connection to that speech and to Dr. King because of it on August 28th. And I mentioned this in my ad, and the focus group of mostly white people who reviewed the ad felt that just by saying that, I was quote unquote playing the race card. This is such a frustrating conversation for Black people that you can't even talk about race without white people accusing us of playing the race card, as if race is a card to be played in the first place. Race is something we live with and we can't hide from. And the fact that white people may not choose to deal with it doesn't make it any more comfortable for us to have to deal with it. But people are often made to feel like there's something wrong with us for even raising the issue. In fact, this just happened to me a couple of days ago. I posted on Twitter, maybe it was yesterday, I've lost track of the days, but I posted on Twitter a comment about this whole Dr. Seuss controversy, which I'm not sure if you heard about, but six of Dr. Seuss's books have been pulled by Dr. Seuss's own estate because of a racist imagery in those books. I made a comment about that, and I said that Abraham Lincoln was a white supremacist, and yet he still signed the Emancipation Proclamation in 1863. And that Lyndon Johnson was a racist Southern Democrat, and yet he still signed the Civil Rights Act of 1964 and the Voting Rights Act of 1965. And my point was that even with all these people, and also with Dr. Seuss, I could acknowledge their contributions to American society at the same time I acknowledge their racism. But a lot of people were invested in this idea, you can't do anything that might take people off the pedestal of our hero worship or idolatry. If we decide that Dr. Seuss is a hero, or Abraham Lincoln or Thomas Jefferson or George Washington, we don't want anyone to say anything critical about them. We don't want anyone to say anything critical about the fact that George Washington pulled the teeth from his slaves so he could put them in his mouth. We don't want anyone to say anything about the fact that Thomas Jefferson raped his own slave and had a child with that slave. We don't want anybody to talk about these realities because we want to hold up people on a pedestal that doesn't take into reality the truth about who we are as a country. So people were calling me a race baiter yesterday on Twitter because I simply made the factual statement about the history of Abraham Lincoln, the history of Lyndon Johnson, the history of Dr. Seuss. But this is what I'm talking about in terms of the way we deal with race in our country today. It's a very complicated issue, and there's a lot of people who are invested in not talking about this issue. So where are we now? Where does this bring us? So it was about 15 years ago that a group of colleagues of mine and I started an organization called the National Black Justice Coalition. We did this in, I guess it wasn't 15 years, it was 2003. We did this in 2003 because that was when the state of Massachusetts became the first state to legalize same-sex marriage. There was a Supreme Court decision in the state of Massachusetts, the same Supreme Court that wouldn't allow us as students to file our lawsuit against Harvard. But the Supreme Court in 2003 in Massachusetts said that marriage equality is now legal. It was legal in the state of Massachusetts. And immediately as a result of that, there was a rush of criticism from a lot of people on the right in the conservative movement, and even a lot of Black people and a lot of Black religious people. And we started seeing Black preachers and pastors on TV almost every day talking about this is against the will of the Black community and Black people don't support this. And again, I thought about what Kimberly Crenshaw said about single issue analyses, and intersectional identity. And I realized that these people were speaking for me, and they didn't speak for me. They didn't even necessarily speak for the overwhelming majority of young Black people who were not with the same mentality of the older Black community. And so we created an organization called the National Black Justice Coalition to speak up on both the issue of racism and homophobia. Hold on just a second here. We wanted to speak about racism and homophobia to acknowledge that these issues are related And that oftentimes the same people who are saying the racist things are the same people who are saying the homophobic things. And so we felt that this is an issue that needed to be stated. And we wanted to create this organization to do this, to fight on intersectionality, to fight against double oppressions and dual oppressions. And it was in 2005 when I had another experience. I'm starting to get a little parched here, I'm sorry. 2005, I had another experience where I was asked by somebody to participate in a march that I didn't want to participate in. It was the anniversary of the Million Man March in 2005. And so what happened was that in 1995, Louis Farrakhan, the controversial leader of the Nation of Islam, who had a history of remarks that were sexist and anti-Semitic and homophobic, created this march on Washington. It was called the Million Man March in 1995, on October 16, 1995. And a lot of people, even in the Black community, were concerned about this march and whether or not we should participate. A lot of Black women were concerned about the sexism. A lot of Black queer people were concerned. So I was, at that point, the executive director of the National Black Lesbian and Gay Leadership Forum. And we decided that we would participate in the march as Black gay men, openly gay Black men, in this Million Man March, in Louis Farrakhan's Million Man March in 1995. We did, and we carried signs into the march chanting, while we were chanting, "We're Black, we're gay, we wouldn't have it any other way." And the sign said, "Black by birth, gay by God, proud by choice." And we weren't sure how we would be received when we got to the assembly of the hundreds of thousands of Black men on the Mall in Washington, D.C. as we marched in. But there was virtually no negative reaction. People were stunned to see us there. Back in the 1990s, this was something wasn't heard of. They were stunned to see us marching into the National Mall with hundreds of thousands of Black men surrounding us, marching in, declaring that we were gay and Black, and we were part of the Black community, and we wouldn't be ignored. And it was almost like the moment in the Ten Commandments, and when the Red Sea parts. As we came to the crowd, the crowd just parted and let us walk through. We just kept marching and marching to the front of the assembly at the rally. So that was in 1995. 10 years later, remember, we weren't invited to participate in the 1995 march. 10 years later, I got a call from Minister Louis Farrakhan himself, who asked if I'd be willing to participate in the Million Man March anniversary. Not me, myself, but the National Black Justice Coalition. And I was shocked that he was actually reaching out to get Black queer people involved in this march, because he wanted to have more people, but he wanted to have bigger numbers. So we sat down and had this very unusual meeting with them back in 2005 to talk about the terms and conditions of the participation. But it was also a reflection, and I'm not saying this as an example of the fact that Minister Farrakhan has become this enlightened person in terms of issues on homophobia, because he hasn't, as far as I can tell. Although he's spoken about me several times since that march. But it was a reflection of just how the Black LGBT community, the Black queer community, was forcing the Black heterosexual community to sort of acknowledge our existence, to come to terms with our role in the community, and the fact that there would be no Black community without the participation of Black LGBTQ people, without the people who participated in the Harlem Renaissance in the 1920s and 1930s, without the people like Lorraine Hansberry, a Black lesbian playwright who wrote A Raisin in the Sun, or without the participation of people like James Baldwin, one of the most prolific and profound African-American authors, who was also a Black gay man, or without the contributions of people like Alvin Ailey, of course, the famous dancer and choreographer, or even the contributions of someone like Bayard Rustin, who was the organizer of the famous 1963 March on Washington, where Dr. King gave his I Have a Dream speech. They were all Black queer people. And Dr. King knew that he was a Black gay man, and Dr. King welcomed him into the movement. And he was criticized for doing that and took some flack for doing that and had to eventually pull back from that. But Bayard Rustin was the person who organized that famous march, and he was the Black gay man in 1963. And so this was a reflection of how things can change. of the importance of speaking truth to power. And this is also where I am today. So I've written a new book. It's called Race Against Time, The Politics of a Darkening America. And the book comes out this September. And it deals with the fact that our country is changing in the way that is making a lot of people very uncomfortable about who we are. And we saw this with the insurrection January 6th. We saw that people were willing to destroy democracy itself rather than to share it with people who don't look like them, who don't think like them, who don't come from the same background. And so we had these four crises that took place last year that we were struggling with. The first was the crisis of the coronavirus, which started almost a year ago at this time in this country. The second was the economic crisis. We shut down businesses and shut down states for several months at a time. And we're still struggling to recover from the economic crisis, even though the stock market is doing well. We have 10 million people who had jobs at this time last year who do not have jobs right now. Third, we had this racial justice crisis that started. It started originally with the death of Breonna Taylor and Ahmaud Arbery in the spring, but it really became a summer movement after the death of George Floyd in Minneapolis on Memorial Day in 2020. And last, we have this crisis of democracy, this fourth crisis, this crisis of democracy, which we saw not only in the insurrection, but in this unwillingness even today to accept the outcome of a democratic, free, and fair election. And all these things are a reflection of just where our country is, and how we get out of this situation is dependent on you. It's dependent on all of us, but it's dependent on you, particularly for the young people in the audience, because we can't continue to live this way as a country. We can't continue to live in a country that is divided to the point where people won't even accept basic reality, where they're in denial about basic science, about the fact that there is such a thing as climate change, or that it does sometimes get cold in the state of Texas, or that the coronavirus is spread from people who don't wear masks. People are in denial about basic science, and there's oftentimes a racial component to this. Once people started realizing late last year, or the middle of last year, rather, that the coronavirus was disproportionately affecting Black and brown people, was almost precisely the time when we started to see less of an interest in following the quarantine orders and following the lockdown restrictions. It's only killing those people. It's not killing us. And this was a disturbing trend that's a reflection of who we are as a country. Now, there's a lot of people going around saying these days, this is not who we are. We're not that kind of country. We're better than this. The reality is actually quite different. This is exactly who we are. This is who America has been since the beginning. It's why Black people were considered three-fifths of a person in the United States Constitution. Why they didn't outlaw slavery in the United States of America until 1865, well after other countries had already done so, including the country that we were supposedly liberated from on Independence Day. It's why women weren't even allowed the right to vote until 1920. It's why people weren't even allowed to vote for United States senators. You couldn't vote directly for a United States senator in this country until the 20th century. In other words, people who, if you wanted to be a United States senator, you had to go to the state legislature, and the state legislature would appoint the senators. There was no direct popular election of United States senators. It's why Black people couldn't even be treated equally in terms of their civil rights, in terms of our civil rights, and the right to sit in a lunchroom or go to a classroom, or even to use a water fountain or a public pool until 1964, when the U.S. government outlawed that, the Civil Rights Act, weren't even guaranteed the right to vote. Despite the passage of the 15th Amendment, weren't even guaranteed the right to vote until the Voting Rights Act of 1965. And even this week, just yesterday, the Supreme Court of the United States seems poised to decide by June of this year to overturn key elements of the Voting Rights Act that are still in place today, making it even easier for conservatives and people who are anti-Black to pass new laws to restrict our right to vote. Well, anyway, I'm losing my voice. I have one more thing I want to say before I take questions. I've been going on for quite some time. I just want to say that these are all complicated issues and complex issues that don't lend themselves to easy answers. But I do believe in the importance of speaking truth to power, and I do believe in the importance of fighting for what you believe. And I learned this lesson from, of all people, my grandmother. And years ago, when I wrote that first book that I mentioned, I did a book signing in St. Louis, Missouri. I travel all across the country, but I did one in St. Louis, Missouri. I went to St. Louis, and my grandmother, without my asking her, showed up the book signing. And she brought members of her church with her. I was a little concerned about why they were there, but they didn't say anything the whole time I did the discussion. It was only during, and even during the Q&A, they didn't say anything. It was only after the event ended that they all came up to me en masse in a group. And I thought, were they going to lay hands on me, or what are they going to do? Why are they coming up to me? And they all came up to me in a group. And I was concerned. And I asked, I said, why did you come here? And they told me that my grandmother, unbeknownst to me, had actually printed up invitations to my event for my book signing. My conservative, Black, religious grandmother not only had done this, she actually gave those invitations to all members of her church that she knew, and gave one to the church announcer so the church announcer could read about it on the Sunday before I had to come to town. I was so shocked by this. I was so surprised. I had no idea this had happened. And I actually asked my grandmother about it, and she acknowledged that she had done this. And I was thinking, I can't believe my grandmother had come this far that she was able to not only embrace me, but to celebrate me to others. And my grandmother told me an interesting story about where our community is and the challenges we still face. She told me that when the church announcer read the bulletin, she made a mistake. The announcement said, the family of Keith Boykin invite you to a book signing for his first book, One More River to Cross, Black and Gay in America. But the church announcer said instead, the family of Keith Boykin invite you to a book signing for his new book, his first book, One More River to Cross, Black and Gray in America. I don't know why the church announcer made that mistake, but I assume it was because she could not imagine that a grandmother, a Black grandmother in this conservative Baptist church in St. Louis, Missouri, could be proud of her gay grandson. So it must have been a mistake. It must have been a misprint. It must have been a book about African-American senior citizens instead of African-American gays and lesbians. But I realized something. I realized that there was power in speaking truth to power. I realized also that there was power in believing in yourself. And I want to leave you with the words of one of my favorite poets, Audre Lorde, a Black lesbian woman, cancer survivor, mother, warrior. And Audre Lorde once wrote, "When I dare to be powerful, to use my strength in the service of my vision, then it becomes less and less important whether I am afraid." And I want to end there because I want you to remember that she doesn't say you won't be afraid. She says it becomes less important whether you are. So the lesson I want to leave with you is this, that when you dare to be powerful, to use your strength in the service of your vision, then it will become less and less important whether you are afraid as well. Thank you, Long Beach. I hope to hear your questions. And I'm finished with my remarks. I'm going to wipe myself off and let's hear what you have to say.
Wow, is simply all that I can say. Thank you, Mr. Boykin. You definitely have dropped some jewels in wisdom to our student body, to our community. We thank you very much for touching on so many great issues that, I mean, I don't even know where we can begin with the questions, but I'll start with...
I'm gonna let my window because I'm burning up in my...
Okay, yeah, sure. Go for it. So allow you a minute to be able to do that.
Right.
Okay. So I'm going to start the questions off with one that I have for you, and it's about the Equality Act. What do you see the chances of the Equality Act passing the United States Senate and, you know, being signed into law by President Biden? And if it were to be signed into law, what would its passage mean to the African-American community?
I think it's a very good chance it will be passed in signed into law. I think the House has already passed it. Mm-hmm. The Senate is expected to pass it. But, you know, we have this really weird situation we're in right now where we have a 50-50 split with the U.S. Senate with Democrats and Republicans. And Kamala Harris, the vice president, is a tie-breaking vote. And so on every issue, we're seeing this now with the minimum wage, for example, raising the minimum wage, where we have 48 Democrats who are willing to go along with it, but two Democrats, Kirsten Sinema, I think it is, of Arizona, and Joe Manchin of West Virginia, are reluctant to do so. And because of that, they're having to renegotiate the whole minimum wage conversation. And so maybe that won't happen after all. And I think we might see that. I don't know where everybody stands on the Equality Act in the Senate, but I imagine, I could be wrong on this, I imagine that even if we have some resistance from those two senators, and I'm not sure, I imagine Matt Manchin and Sinema support this, but I don't know if that's for sure. But I'm sure, maybe I'm wrong, but I imagine that there are two Republicans who'd be willing to support this. Maybe Susan Collins or Lisa Murkowski, not sure. But it's just, it's amazing to me also when I hear people talk about the Democratic Party, Republican Party being exactly the same. I know it's really loud out now because the window's open, but I'm sorry about that. But clearly, in case after case, they're clearly not the same. But in terms of the African-American community, I think it will have an impact on the African-American community because we tend to think of the LGBTQ community as being monolithically white and privileged, and it's not always the case. Obviously, there are a lot of Black people who can benefit from legislation like this. The problem I have is that we oftentimes, we pass legislation and we forget about how you make that legislation fair. So you can pass a law and say, well, we're going to outlaw discrimination based on sexual orientation, but it doesn't. We still have to deal with the underlying issues of socioeconomic unfairness and disparities in our country. So Black and brown people still don't have the same access to resources. And anytime you pass a discrimination law, the law isn't self-enforcing. So if I'm working at a company, a gas station, for example, and the gas station chooses to fire me because they find out I'm gay, chances are, even though I know that's against the law, if I know it's against the law, I don't necessarily have the resources to go to a court and file a lawsuit to do something about that. I don't even know necessarily where to go to find a lawyer. And besides, I'm so busy just trying to figure out, like, how am I going to take care of myself every day? I don't have time to think about those types of things. So I do think it's important to understand the limited effect of what legislation can do, and that we have to, it's important, yes, we also have to create the mechanism to reform society writ large so that we can make sure that we have equal access for everyone in our country.
Thank you. Our next question comes from Suman Mendidori. And her question is that Long Beach focuses a lot on equity work for our students, but still struggles with the with that amongst our faculty and staff. So many have been silenced by retaliation or invisibility for speaking up. Do you have any advice for those of us who have trauma attached for speaking up in an environment that still has individuals in positions of quote unquote power who may never get it?
My only advice is to find an affirming community of other people who support what you're doing, or to find ways to validate yourself. One of the most difficult things about being a change maker or being on the harbinger, a harbinger of change, is that you don't necessarily find a lot of support for what you're doing at the time you're doing it. I remember back in the 1990s when I was leading the National Black Lesbian Gay Leadership Forum. And I was fighting all the time with people in the Black community. Even with BET, I remember specifically with BET, there's a guy named Tavis Smalley. I'm not sure if he still has a show anymore, but Tavis Smalley had a TV show in the 1990s. It was a very popular late night TV show on BET. I went on several times and knew Tavis fairly well at that time. And I went on several times to talk about Black LGBTQ issues. And oftentimes there's a lot of resistance from people in the Black community, from church leaders. In fact, in one time, I remember I was scheduled to go on with Angie and Debbie Winans, part of the famous Gospel Winans family, because they were upset about gay people getting equal rights, and they wanted to express their objection to it. So I was on, I was supposed to be on with them, but they refused to go on with me. So I got a call from BET saying, I'm sorry, we're going to have to cancel you. I couldn't believe it. So I was like, you're going to listen to these homophobes? You're not going to have somebody there to provide a counter perspective? So we in our organization started a campaign that day, literally, and this was before the internet. Well, actually, it was at the beginning of the internet, before people really could use the internet the way they can, definitely before social media. We began a campaign to get people to call in to BET to force them back down. And they did, and they allowed me to come on the show. But I remember every time I'd go on a Black radio station back in the day, people would just be criticizing, you know, Black people would be criticizing me, quoting the Bible scriptures to me about why what I was doing was wrong. You don't hear those people as much today. They still exist, no doubt. But I think what one of the things I've learned from my lessons, from my experience, and the advice I could give is that sometimes you have to do the work, even though there may not be not a reward to it, but you may not even see exactly the goal you want to reach. And you may even be pilloried and castigated because of that. And the only way you're going to make it through, the only way you're going to make it through is if you A, find a way to validate yourself, or B, find other people who are supportive, who are doing something similar, or at least encouraging what you're doing, so you have a community of people to validate you as well.
Thank you. So we have two questions that are kind of similar here that are looking at and asking about the United States Senate. And in particular, we have a question from Daniel Rosales, who asks, how will we take away two senators per state, all while including these particular areas of the United States that you mentioned before, that there were issues with the population changes and, you know, with the election results, and make sure not only that their voices are being heard, but they're actually actionable. And then I guess to add on to that, we have another question about the Senate here from Janae Hund, who asked, like, what opportunities are there to make a structural change if we were to change the composition of the Senate?
Okay, so those are excellent questions. I'm going to give you both three answers: a short-term answer, a medium-term answer, and a long-term answer. Short-term answer: expand the Senate. We could do that by adding statehood for D.C., which would give you two more Democratic senators for sure, possibly even black senators, because even though D.C. is no longer majority black, it has a history of electing black elected officials. The current mayor of D.C. is black. And the current delegate in D.C., Eleanor Holmes Norton, who is not a voting member of the district of the Congress, she's also black. So that gives you two potentially black Democratic senators. Another option with this is also to include Puerto Rico. I'm not sure if Puerto Rico has had a referendum on this to indicate they want to do this. But if they do, that's likely two more people of color who are also Democrats. That helps to balance out the Wyomings of the world and the Montanas of the world. That's short term. Medium term strategy, Charles Blow has a new book out. Charles Blow is a New York Times columnist. He has a new book out called The Devil You Know. Charles Blow is also a black queer writer. But he's a New York Times columnist. He's encouraging black people to move to the South, particularly in states like Georgia, where if you move to states like Georgia, Mississippi, and Alabama, and South Carolina, and North Carolina, Virginia, because black people have such a significant percentage of the population in those states already, that if you move a critical mass of black people there, they could actually become a majority and elect black senators, black progressive senators throughout that entire region. So just like we have a whole region of the Northwest, if you look at, you know, outside of Oregon and Washington, look at Montana, I keep mentioning Montana, North Dakota, South Dakota, Wyoming, all those places in Idaho out there where they have practically nobody who lives there, but they have a ton of U.S. senators who are all white and all Republican, all conservative for the most part, except for one in Montana. We could do the same thing, create a region of influence in the South by having black people move from places where they're not necessarily as welcome as they are, as you would think they would be in the North or the Midwest or the West, and move to places like Georgia and North Carolina and Virginia. That's a short-term strategy. Long-term strategy is we're going to have to reform the Constitution. If anything we learned from 4 years of Donald Trump, the Constitution is fundamentally flawed. Everybody talked about this as some brilliant document. It's able to anticipate all the problems that come up, and clearly it's unable to do any of those things. We couldn't keep and hold in check this one authoritarian-ish leader in office who was violating the Constitution left and right, and there was no mechanism in place to hold him accountable. After two impeachment trials, after violating the Emoluments Clause, it says you're not supposed to receive funding from outside sources as a president, he was able to do that, hide his tax returns for 4 years, and avoid almost any kind of accountability for rampant corruption. Clearly, the Constitution itself needs to be reformed. And part of that reform is we need to think about the way we apportion U.S. senators. It makes no sense that California, the largest state in the country, has only two United States senators. California, also one of the most diverse states in the country, by the way, has only two United States senators. So that's my three-part response.
Okay, thank you very much for that. The next question comes to us from Catherine McMurray, who asked, today, how do we counter people when they continue to claim that more diversity or more inclusion leads to lower quality candidates or lower standards?
It's just not true. Just as I was saying before with the example of Barack Obama at Harvard Law School, it's an old argument that needs to be addressed because there's plenty of qualified, competent people out there. First of all, a lot of institutions don't even go looking for them. You know, if you go looking at the same places over and over, you're going to get the same results. They said the definition of insanity is doing the same thing over and over again, expecting a different outcome. This is what happens. Well, we go to this school all the time and we don't ever find anybody because the school has like 1% Black population or 1% Latino population, and you expect to find people there. Go to the schools and institutions where you have a larger concentration of African-American and Latinx people, then you're likely to find those people. Also, we have to rethink this whole idea of meritocracy in the first place. What exactly is a meritocracy? Was it a meritocracy when rich white guys like Donald Trump got into Ivy League universities when they had no qualifications to do so, or when they were able to buy their way in because of their parents' contributions, or because they have a legacy because somebody they knew in that family already attended that school? Is that a meritocracy? Is it a meritocracy when white men who are 29% of the population control 95% of the levers of government in that country, 90% of the economic levers of power in our country? That's not a meritocracy. We've never had a meritocracy. What we've done is we've given privilege to a white patriarchal group of people and restricted access for other people, and then complained that they weren't able to compete. When Black people and brown people and people of color in general are able to be held to the same sort of standards of mediocre white guys, then maybe we will have a meritocracy. But right now, we've never had that in our country. And the notion that we can suddenly have one is insulting and offensive. But there are plenty of qualified, talented Black and brown people out there for jobs and positions that institutions just have to do a more thorough job of going to look for them and not looking for them amongst their friends and colleagues and reinforcing the status quo.
Okay. Our next question comes from Dan Hanisch, who asks, would you be able to speak to the connection between the Trump presidency and the Black Lives Matter movement?
Well, I mean, it's just sort of a broad question. It's interesting because, I mean, Trump obviously was not a supporter of the Black Lives Matter movement, but the Black Lives Matter movement didn't start because of Donald Trump. It started actually in the Obama administration. Depending on where you want to begin the starting point, but Trayvon Martin was killed when Obama was president, as was Michael Brown and others. And it's a reflection of the fact that there's a tendency to assume that by electing a Democrat, that somehow resolves all your problems. That's not true. We're seeing that now with Joe Biden. We have a Democrat in office, and we still have... First of all, electing one black person, you know, didn't solve racism. Electing one Democrat isn't going to solve conservatism either. And especially considering the fact that most white people did not vote for Barack Obama in either of his elections. I always hate it when white people say, "Oh, we gave you Obama. What else do you darkies want?" And are you kidding me? The nerve of you! The reality is that the majority of white people have not voted for a Democratic candidate for president since 1964. That was the year when Lyndon Johnson signed the Civil Rights Act. Democrat Lyndon Johnson signed the Civil Rights Act. Ever since that time, no Democratic candidate for president has won the white vote. That tells you everything. So in terms of Donald Trump and Black Lives Matter, I mean, Donald Trump is an extension of his political party's racial views going back for 50 years with the Southern strategy. I don't like to focus too much on Trump as the problem because he is just a symptom of a problem. He is not the problem itself. The problem is the systems in place that enable people like Trump to come to power. In fact, the problem is that even after all the racism and sexism and bigotry and xenophobia and discrimination and corruption we saw for 4 years in this administration, and we still had 74 million people who voted for him, and we still have a significant number of people who still believe he won the election, even though his own FBI director, his own Homeland Security director, his own attorney general, both all say that the election was free and fair and without fraud. So this is a reflection of how dangerous racism is. Racism is a hell of a drug. It's got people convinced to follow a cult leader who has no interest in representing their interest rather than following their own actual socioeconomic needs.
Thank you. We have time for one more question. And this last question comes to us from Camilla Collins, who asks, how do we lend our voices to fighting against the potential changes to the Voting Rights Act?
This is a difficult question because the reality is, let me look at this as a two-track issue. In terms of the judicial component, there's nothing we can do. Honestly, I hate to say it, but there's nothing we can do. The Supreme Court is likely going to weaken the Voting Rights Act, probably when it issues its decision, probably in June. You heard it here first, which means that unless we expand the court and take up a new case, that's going to take several years, which means the only real solution is to go through a legislative approach or constitutional approach. And legislative is probably easier, which means Congress is going to have to pass a new Voting Rights Act. And there is currently an act under consideration in Congress, the John Lewis Voting Rights Act, John Lewis Voting Rights Bill, which I urge you to support that, to call your representative. I imagine in Long Beach, whoever your representative is probably supports that, although it could be wrong. I'm sure that your senators do. But to call your representatives, and if you are from someplace outside of California or outside of Long Beach, and you have connection to that or you have family in those places, have those family members or you yourself call the members from those places. You know, that's one more thing I want to say real quickly. A lot of times when people are in college, they forget that they have other connections, other people outside of that community. So colleges tend to be in liberal enclaves that are not necessarily reflective of the way other people are outside of those groups, of the areas. And it's important to realize you still have power. If you come from somewhere outside of Long Beach, use that power there where you can have that influence and speak up and call your representative even there if it's not in that same area.
Well, thank you very much for joining us today, Mr. Boykin, and for sharing your story with us today. We really appreciate it, and I'm sure that our students got a lot out of it. I know that I did, and you know, I'm glad that you were able to join us to conclude our Black Heritage Month here. So right now, I would like to turn it over to Dr. Alicia Kirkwood, Dean of Student Affairs and the Chair of our Black Heritage Month Committee, for some closing remarks.
Thank you, Dr. Hunt. Wow, Mr. Boykin, as my uncles, may their souls continue to rest in peace, would say, you gave us a lot to chew on. This has been such a dynamic and profound intersectional history lesson. When I had the opportunity to chair this committee, the one thing I continue to say is we want to make sure that we educate while we celebrate. And I think this has been just divine order for this to be the closing event for our Black Heritage Month celebrations this year. So thank you again for being here with us. And thank you, Dr. Hunt, for your vision of bringing Mr. Boykin to our campus. I think it is right on time. Once again, on behalf of our newly appointed interim superintendent president, Dr. Mike Munoz, we thank you also for being here. As a committee, we thank Dr. Munoz for his vision for our campus. This type of programming is indicative of that. Next, to the most amazing Black Heritage Month planning committee out there, you all were fabulous. I appreciate your passion and your commitment to this work. You all showed up every time, every meeting you had. It was just a joy to lead this group. A special shout out to Navon Watson, who I get to work with daily because he serves as my director for student conduct and student life. But Navon was essential in ensuring the student voice was not only present, but it was prevalent in all of our planning and execution. And that was two reminders, two takeaways I took from Mr. Boykin's talk today is, one, a reminder of the power of the student voice. We cannot lose sight of that. In our history, the student voice has been at the forefront of so much change that has occurred. But also, I love that he really focused on the importance of our commitment to our own personal truths and our own authentic self. And so those things were just fabulous. And I think that our students had an opportunity to do that through this month of activities. Thank you to the Long Beach community and the community at large for showing up. I mean, our attendance for our events was, it was just phenomenal. So thank you for that. And so lastly, though, finally, I would be remiss if I did not really speak to our students and thank each of them. They researched, they led amazing interviews and discussions. They shared their talents with us through song and spoken word. And for that, I say thank you to our students. You all are amazing. You all are the reason why I do this work. I do this work for the students. I do this work for my colleagues. And my heart is just so full and my cup runneth over. So with that, I say to you all, thank you again and be well, everyone. I hope you have enjoyed the events. And remember, we are now in International Women's History Month, and we have another calendar full of fabulous scholars, practitioners, and experiences for you all to share in there as well. Thank you all, and have a wonderful day.